Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all of you. I'm Catherine Marshall. I'm at the Berkley Center at Georgetown University, which is co-hosting this webinar with Jubilee USA and with the G20 Interfaith Forum. And we are here to look at the agendas for the spring meetings, as they're called, of the IMF and the World Bank, which start on the 10th of April. This is one of the critical gatherings that takes place each year when ministers of finance, ministers of planning, central bank governors, but also private sector, civil society, people all converge on Washington, D.C. to look at the global agendas, largely from a financial and economic perspective. But this year, I would note that many other issues are coming into focus, including climate. We are particularly concerned and focused on the roles that religious communities are playing on these global issues in the midst of what many are calling the polycrisis, where there seem to be issues, geopolitical, economic, social, financial, everywhere we look, and they all are so much interconnected. As a practical matter, this webinar is being recorded and it will be made available on the websites of the different organizations, the three organizations that are co-sponsoring the event. I encourage you to raise any questions in the Q&A button, which we all know so well, at the bottom of your screen. So meanwhile, as we look at the agendas for the upcoming meetings, I'm going to turn to each of the three panelists, Eric LeConte from Jubilee USA, Athena Peralta from the World Council of Churches, and Father Charles Chilufya, to give us their perspectives, the issues that are most on their minds, and of course, what they would like to see the world's leaders, the governors of the major multilateral institutions, the private business leaders, but above all, the G20, which is one of our areas of focus. So let me turn first to Eric LeConte. I'm going to suggest that you introduce yourselves. We have the bios already that are available, but maybe talk a little bit about what Jubilee USA is doing, where it came from, and what you see as the major agenda items as you look to the week ahead.
Thank you, Catherine. It's a pleasure to be with you and with all of you today as we prepare for the critical IMF, World Bank, and G20 meetings taking place here in Washington next week. Jubilee USA is an interfaith religious organization that was founded 25 years ago by a call from Pope John Paul II and major religious leaders, initially to deal with the causes of poverty, of inequality, focusing on the debt crisis. There was a global adage 25 years ago that debt means death. And the reality that we faced as Jubilee USA, as an interfaith movement, was that we saw that countries throughout the developing world, Latin America, Africa, Asia, Caribbean, they were spending more on debt payments than they were on healthcare, social infrastructure, education, and all social services combined. Jubilee worked with many of the groups and organizations over the last 25 years on this call to essentially move forward several debt relief processes 25 years ago. Since then, the calling of Jubilee, which is a religious theme that we see in the Hebrew and Christian scriptures, but essentially this idea that God has given us a rich and abundant world, and we're closest to God, to the Creator, when we're sharing that abundance, those resources among us. And that's ultimately what the calling of Jubilee is. So we work on structural policies, debt, tax, transparency, corruption, climate, and how those particular issues impact the vulnerable, how they impact inequality. So as we celebrate our 25-year history, one of the sad challenges as we go into next week's meeting is that many of the countries that struggled 25 years ago, who were paying more on debt payments than they were on healthcare and education, unfortunately are now in a similar place. And we know the state of the affairs of the world since the pandemic. Most people are worse off. This morning, Kristalina Georgieva, the head of the International Monetary Fund, gave her annual curtain raiser speech, which she gives a few days before the IMF, World Bank, and G20 meetings to foreshadow some of the themes. And it was a real bad news speech. She reported that the IMF is expecting that we're going to continue to see sluggish growth below previous estimates. We're continuing to deal with global challenges of inflation, of a food crisis, of a debt crisis that are all intertwined and connected, and all, of course, touch the growing and concerning climate crisis. These particular polycrises, as Catherine referred to them, are really at the heart of dealing with debt issues, tax issues, trade and transparency issues, about making sure that everyone in the world has enough. And so since the pandemic, things have gotten worse. Before the pandemic, we saw in 2018 that more than 15 million children were dying, according to the United Nations, annually under the age of 15 years old because of malnutrition, because of poverty, because of preventable diseases. 5.3 million of those kids were under the age of five. We've seen those numbers actually worsen since the crisis, and more children enter the ranks of poverty. Right now, across Africa, 280 million people, one out of five of every Africans is now facing severe hunger and food crisis. In the Horn of Africa, we're dealing with a terrible challenge from the food crisis that's actually expanding the food crisis, with the reality that without food to feed animals, a pastoral region, the Horn of Africa, 9.5 million animals that families rely on have died since 2022. Those numbers are staggering. And in the face of these numbers, all of these countries are facing growing debt crises. In fact, 60% of all low-income countries in the world are facing debt crisis right now, where over a quarter of middle-income emerging market developing countries are also facing debt crisis. This has been a huge concern since the dawn of the pandemic for the IMF, the World Bank, and the G20. And in terms of their agenda, the way that they're trying to move forward debt relief is by continuing what's called the Sovereign Debt Roundtable. It's bringing together stakeholders from the private sector, from countries that are in debt, from lending countries, and other international leaders to try and get consensus to move forward one of the debt relief processes the G20 has worked on, the common framework for debt relief. That process has generally stalled, and the hope is that at the coming week of meetings for the IMF, World Bank, and G20, that there'll be reports that there will be a breakthrough with this group in terms of moving forward debt relief. The problems with debt relief right now primarily is that the private sector, which holds significant portions of the debt, is refusing to participate. So the Sovereign Debt Roundtable, and one of the main agenda points on debt in the coming week, is trying to move forward this common framework process and other processes for debt relief for countries. At Jubilee USA, with the challenges with this process, we haven't been waiting. And that's why we introduced the New York Taxpayer and International National Debt Crisis Protection Act in New York State. When this legislation passes before June 1st, it will compel the private sector to come to the table, not only for this current G20 IMF initiative, but also any additional initiatives that world leaders come up with. It's incredibly important. We also know on the agenda is around increasing capacity for the multilateral development banks, the MDBs. This has been a very important priority for Jubilee since the beginning of the pandemic, as well as many of our global partners, because these are the lenders that are often closest to countries facing problems. They can get money out the quickest, and they also are able to get financing and aid out on highly concessional terms. So we need to increase funding for the multilateral development banks. Many of us have also worked on the special drawing rights. And again, we will hear about this special drawing rights, this emergency currency of $650 billion that was created by the International Monetary Fund and approved by the G20. That has essentially meant that $240 billion has gone to low-income and middle-income developing countries. And now there's a commitment to rechannel, or for the wealthy countries with their roughly $400 billion that they've received, to be able to reallocate those and channel it to developing countries. And while we'll hear about that, we'll also continue our calls this week for a new creation, a new allocation of this emergency financing aid. And this financing aid was so critical and important. It really was a very important victory for us, because it's the first time that this type of liquidity financing was actually used as emergency response aid and as development aid. So we need to continue our focus on that, and that will again be an issue that comes up during the meetings this weekend. I think the last things to say generally about some of the issues that we'll hear about, we'll continue to hear more about issues around transparency, around trade. We'll hear more about both the global corporate minimum tax, as well as looking at tax issues and implementation of tax issues, given the reality that many corporations, as well as many groups and institutions, use tax loopholes. So there has been a positive move to shore up these loopholes. So when we're looking at the agenda, it's an important agenda. I think our question is whether or not we're moving quickly enough, given the reality that the crisis is growing, given the reality that we heard from Kristalina Georgieva this morning, that things are worse than we thought they were, and all around the world, whether it's the US, whether it's Zambia, Kenya, Honduras, we're all paying more for eggs, coffee, flour, for unga. And these particular commodities, which are being priced out of people's existence that we rely on, are intertwined with the global debt crisis, the inflation crisis, and the food crisis. Only by dealing with the debt crisis will the G20 and the IMF start to address inflation and start to address the challenges we're facing on every continent, where eggs, flour, coffee, unga are getting priced out of existence. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Eric. I think you've highlighted one of the important dimensions of what the religious communities have been able to achieve over the years of taking what can be very technical, complex issues and translating them into people, but also into an ethical framework. We're also very much aware of the call to the religious communities to serve as the prophetic voice that reminds us of our obligations and also of our possibilities, as well as the challenges. So let's turn now to Athena Peralta. She's still in Geneva, but on her way to Washington with the World Council of Churches. And you're very much involved in some of these interconnecting issues that we're highlighting here, that climate and debt and SDRs and global tax and food all have very complex interactions. So over to you.
Thank you so much, Catherine. And indeed, both you and Eric You spoke about the polycrisis that are confronting our world today. And indeed, I think it is today so much clearer, especially with the release of the synthesis of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change's sixth assessment report, that the climate emergency is really the existential challenge of our generation, intersecting with other crises that we face today, including the food crisis, the fuel climate-related shocks that are growing in intensity and in frequency. And we know that this climate emergency is not, you know, it's not merely an environmental phenomenon, but it is one with very profound implications on economies, on societies, on the health and livelihoods of people, especially those living in poverty. I work with the World Council of Churches, and we have often said, you know, that the groaning of creation and the cry of those living in poverty are one. And indeed, the victims of climate change today, you could say, are, you know, the new face of the poor. We know, and studies confirm, that poverty makes people vulnerable to the impacts of climate change. And at the same time, the response of many countries in the global south to this mounting climate challenge is very much impaired by heavy debt burdens. So countries such as the Philippines, where I'm from, need support, not least financial support, in building resilience to the health crisis and the climate crisis, and in dealing with the impacts of climate change. So I come from a country that is particularly vulnerable to climate change. In 2022, the Philippines ranked first on the list of global disaster risk hotspots based on the World Risk Index. So an average of 20 typhoons batter our islands every year. And these typhoons, as you know, have become stronger. The typhoon seasons have become much longer, stretching, for instance, into the months of November and December, which was not the case when I was growing up. And every year, the story is the same. The typhoons leave in their wake lost lives, demolished houses and infrastructure, destroyed fishing boats, crops, and agricultural plots, displaced communities, and devastated livelihoods. A report from the Department of Finance of the Philippines, you know, showed that the Philippines is bound to incur around 28 billion US dollars in losses from natural disasters in the next 5 years. And of course, the losses are expected to increase as climate change worsens. So 28 billion is around, you know, 8% of the country's GDP. So that is a huge amount. And every year we rebuild, the damaged infrastructure, the ravaged agricultural lands, the housing. And so we are very much locked into this costly build and, you know, rebuild cycle. And this is a cycle that entails countries such as mine taking on more and more debt. There was an study released by UNCTAD early this year pointing out that 71% of climate finance continues to be provided in the form of debt. And this is mainly channeled into mitigation. And yet we know that the annual adaptation costs for developing countries to adapt to climate change would be around $250 billion by 2030. And it's precisely because of this nexus between climate change and the debt crisis that we really see this vicious cycle. We see the need for rising investment requirements in order for countries such as mine to become climate resilient. And at the same time, we are increasingly, you know, dependent on costly debt financing for this. And this is simply unsustainable. So you might ask, what is the, you know, what is the role of churches in this? And, you know, in the aftermath of storms and the aftermath of natural disasters, we know that religious communities, such as churches, you know, are often among the very first responders because they're embedded in the community. And so practically speaking, for instance, churches have opened up, you know, their places of worship, their buildings to refugees, to climate refugees, to displaced, climate displaced people, for instance, as temporary shelters. But, you know, obviously this is not enough. And Catherine spoke earlier about the church's prophetic voice. And indeed, you know, our teachings, religious teachings tell us that we have an obligation to care for the earth and to care for the most vulnerable among us. And this care, this obligation to care for the most vulnerable and to care for the planet has to be lived out clearly in our daily practices, for instance, as Christians, in our humanitarian work and programs. But this is not enough. These obligations also have to be embedded and embodied in national and global policy frameworks, in financial and economic governance structures. And this means that churches cannot shy away from the critical work of national and global advocacy. And this is the, you know, the prophetic voice of the churches. We need churches, for instance, to be calling for climate adaptation and loss and damage finance based on the polluters pay principle, for instance, in the global climate governance arena or the climate change conferences. We need churches to be calling for the cancellation of debt of climate vulnerable nations in arenas such as the spring meetings, the upcoming spring meetings of the IMF and the World Bank. And this is necessary. This call for debt cancellation is necessary to support climate impacted communities so that they're able to rebuild their lives. So ultimately, we need as churches to address the root causes of climate change. And of course, this means doing all that we can to sharply bring down carbon emissions and keep warming to not more than 1.5 degrees Celsius. And ultimately, this means building a different kind of economy, an economy that meets the needs of all and nurtures our only ecological home, an economy that promotes sustainable consumption and production, that reduces socioeconomic inequalities at national and global level, an economy that ditches economic growth as its goal. And I think I will end here for now. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I think you've highlighted very vividly both the dangers and the opportunities and the collective obligations, the dangers of the vicious circle, but also some of the very practical imperatives that are part of the partnerships that we talk about so much, that this is not simply a responsibility of the ministers of finance or the heads of state of the G20. It's a collective responsibility that deals with the existential challenges that you have, I think, outlined so vividly. Father Charles, you're sitting today in Nairobi, but you also are on your way to Washington for these meetings. Can you give us your sense of, if you had the possibility, what would these finance ministers and central bank, IMF, multilateral development bank, what must they do to try to address all of these different dimensions?
Thank you very much. Eric has gone through a number of issues affecting developing countries and poorer countries, especially here in Africa, talking about the debt problems, the insolvency, and all the other issues. And this is happening when countries in Africa are facing very high risks in form of climate risks and the harsh climate impacts, especially the ones that we have experienced the last number of years, which have become more often and more common. And clearly, countries are finding it very difficult to respond to these issues, which are exacerbating already existing problems around food insecurity, around hunger, and poverty in general. And that was done very well. But I'd like to maybe speak to an issue around why countries are indebted and what needs to be done in order to sort of stem these problems of financing. We know very well that in the wake of COVID-19, almost all the African countries became broke. They ran out of cash to respond to the harsh impacts of COVID-19. The trouble is that for low and lower middle income countries to pursue recovery, in this case or development goals, and do their part in tackling these problems like climate, poverty, they need to be able to have access to financing and to borrow reliably on decent market terms. But the current global financial system extends this privilege almost exclusively to rich countries. And Eric spoke to the imbalance in the allocation of SDR. That's another topic for another day. But this kind of imbalance and these deep problems are what the church is concerned about. And Pope Francis speaks about an economy that kills, which we need to move away from and introduce an economy that brings life. And the current two-tiered global financial system that extends privilege almost exclusively to rich countries is an economy that kills, one that we cannot rely upon. We have heard in various COPs, especially in the last two, three COPs, where hundreds of financial institutions, including countries, declared that they would put trillions of dollars that would work to finance solutions to climate change. Yet we all know, like I've mentioned, that there is always a barrier in the way because of the way the financial architecture is set, the global one, which impedes the flow of money, of finance to developing countries, and creates a death trap for many. We know that for Africa and other poorer countries to recover fully from COVID-19 impacts and other impacts that exacerbate poverty, we need funding to respond to our health and education needs, infrastructure, transport, and all of the needs we have to run our economies, including the growth of businesses that run the economy. But poorer countries don't have this kind of capital at the moment. And as we have seen in the last number of years, the level has even gone much lower than before. Global bond markets, banking systems should be able to provide sufficient funds for the high growth catch-up phase of sustainable development, but this does not happen. As I've mentioned, the flow of funds from whatever source in the north to developing countries remains very small and very costly to the borrowers and unstable. Developing countries borrow at interest charges that are often 5 to 10% higher per year than the borrowing costs paid by rich countries, which range between 0.8 to 1 to 2%, compared to the highs of 5 to 10% for developing countries. Developing country borrowers are also regarded as high risk, as we saw in the wake of COVID-19. And we saw the bonding rate agencies assign lower ratings by mechanical formula to countries just because they are poor. That put a stop on the flow of finances to these countries. And they, when they needed the cash, they couldn't get it. So what happens to far too many developing countries like the ones in Africa? Happens for arbitrary reasons, which can be changed. And like I said, all of this results in sudden stops of new lending to governments. Without access to refinancing, governments will be forced into defaults, as we have seen in the case of Zambia and Ghana, and several other countries are going that way. The government in Africa have no other recourse. They usually turn to the International Monetary Fund for emergency financing. What we have seen is that the restoration of a government's global financial reputation takes a long time, as it has taken for Zambia. I think it took 7 years before Zambia could get back onto a program. And there are several others that are still struggling and could not have access to interest-free loans or low-interest loans. But rich country governments that borrow internationally in their own currencies do not face the same risks of sudden stops of lending because they have their own central banks that act as lenders of the last resort and support their countries. The same is true for Europe. So the point I'm making is that the entire financial architecture needs to be re-looked at. At the moment, an average African country is broke and they have no other source of financing. In fact, all of them almost, especially the sub-Saharan African countries, are only lucky because we have the flow of SDRs, which have made a difference, but they are far from meeting the needs, the financing needs of these countries. Yeah. The major, an overhaul of the global financial system is urgent and should be part of conversations like the ones that we'll be having. Developing countries with good growth prospects and vital development needs should be able to borrow reliably on decent markets, market terms. So what the G20 and the IMF and the World Bank should be doing is to devise a new and improved credit rating system that accounts for each country's growth prospects and long-term debt sustainability. Banking regulations such as those of the Bank for international settlements should then be revised according to the improved credit rating system to facilitate more bank lending to developing countries. What more can be done? The G20 and the IMF and World Bank should reuse their financial firepower to support a liquid secondary market in developing country sovereign bonds. Including the Fed, the ECB, and other key central banks should establish currency swaps lines with central banks in low-income and lower middle-income countries. The World Bank and other development finance institutions also should greatly increase their grants and concessional loans to developing countries, especially the poorest. Other issues that should be taken to the fore and to discussion is the importance of financing multilateral bank institutions like the Africa Development Bank so that they are able to respond to the financing needs of local countries here in Africa, because they would know better the needs of the continent and what is at stake. Yeah. So basically, what we should expect is, as Eric mentioned, to deepen the questions of why the countries that were indebted received debt relief and all of a sudden are back online in are back in terms of facing the problems of illiquidity and are not able to finance their own needs. So high on the agenda also then what we in the church circles would worry about is the reform of the international financial architecture so that it allows the flow of finance from the north to the south, especially when there's greatest need, as is the case now. I haven't even touched on other aspects that sort of impede the flow of finance to the south, like tax evasion and several related problems, let alone the capital flight that we experienced in the wake of COVID-19. So in other words, even as we look at critical and immediate problems like the problem of debt, we should also be talking about going deeper so that the countries in the South, especially those in Africa, do not continue to go into this cycle of debt cancellation and then back to the similar problems of indebtedness and illiquidity. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I think you've given us a very vivid picture of the scale of the challenge, but also the depth of the kinds of solutions that we're looking at. We're looking not only at not billions, but trillions of dollars. We're looking at a very large number of countries that are basically barely managing day to day. And we're looking at the rather complex roles of different religious communities as they look at this set of challenges and crises. Let's do a very quick round with each of you. Both I'll ask you questions, but also ask each other or challenge each other. We have a large number of very probing questions, which some of which we'll get to, some of which we'll need to come back to. But let me start with Eric. You and I have had discussions over the years about this question of financial architecture and the need for some very deep and fundamental changes in the way that international financial links work and in some of the mechanisms. How far do you see that on the agenda next week? And how do the advocates for a more just and fair and sustainable or resilient system, how do they move forward as we look at the challenges we face?
Well, I think the reality is that we are definitely facing perhaps the most significant crisis and series of crises in our lifetime. And I think to pick up on some of the points that were made by you, Catherine, as well as Athena and Father Charles, is I think this idea of where the prophetic meets the need for real change in the global financial system. And I think the main place that we're going to see that interact with the agenda is that we are in a new Bretton Woods moment, certainly with the World Bank, as well as the International Monetary Fund. As we are moving forward with a new World Bank president, it's very clear that there's a strong reform agenda that's associated with moving forward a new president of the World Bank. And I think this is really where we get to this question of prophetic and the international financial system that Charles was raising and that you're raising with your question, Catherine, is that while debt relief, aid, all of these issues are very significant and we need to move them forward. And as we move them forward, we're hopefully creating new structures and new processes. But we are, I think, as Father Charles noted, dealing with a fundamentally unfair system where the system is rigged for wealthy countries. And we're dealing with much of the developing world having abundant resources that are continuing to flow to the north while many of these developing countries are impoverished. So we really need to look at how do we change and reform the institutions so that there are equal votes among members. Right now, the votes of the IMF and World Bank are controlled really by the United States and Europe. So we need to move forward this idea of quota reform, but so that institutions can be more participatory. And we actually need to take this particular moment of a new World Bank president to look at this reality that the institutions need to change more if they're going to deal with current global crises as well as future crises.
But Eric, where can this conversation best take place? How do you basically move it from different voices crying out even in anger or in despair or with wonderful ideas to something that looks practical? Is the G20 the best instrument? Is it these meetings that are taking place? What would you see if I wave my magic wand? What might happen to take these discussions beyond the screen, shall we say?
Right. Well, and I think that falls on all of us, and it's really our responsibility to engage the decision makers. So while I think we want to continue our calls and our work to create new processes and new systems, we need to really engage the decision makers of the IMF and World Bank. And the reality is that those are wealthy countries. They're G20 countries. And while there are developing countries that are part of the G20 for the most part is what's calling the shots at the IMF. So if we want to see real institutional change, if we want to seize a new Bretton Woods moment to change these institutions and reform them, we have to focus very specifically on G20 governments. And I think that's where the G20 Interfaith Alliance, where a lot of the work that you've done, Catherine, is really critical. And I think what we're trying to do at Jubilee is help support organization of delegations in capitals to be able to push governments to move forward on debt relief, on trade, on tax and transparency. And ultimately, it's going to be these countries that have to move forward the quota reform in terms of being able to have more equal voting rights at the IMF. Mm-hmm. Specifically, the G20 has to be our focus if we want to move forward changes to the global financial system. And we do that, and we believe the faith voice is absolutely critical by starting to communicate actively with capitals throughout the year on these particular issues.
Great, thank you. Athena, let me pick up on one of the questions, which I think is in a sense where you were focusing, is trying to make the link between the realities that you've lived and that people you know have lived and these high level meetings that take place in Washington, D.C. and in other capitals and Geneva, et cetera. How do you see making these links stronger and bringing these voices into the conversations in ways that are both practical, but also really highlight where the suffering is, where the opportunities are?
Thank you for that question, Catherine. And at this point, I mean, the challenges in front of us are like so immense and so encompassing and intersecting with so many other crises, as has been previously mentioned, that it's almost as if we have to be acting and doing our advocacy work everywhere. what is the title of that movie? All the time,
everything, everywhere,
everything, exactly. And I think Antonio Guterres, the UN Secretary General, also said something similar. And so we have to be at numerous spaces. Obviously, the IMF and World Bank, spring meetings, the G20, as has been mentioned by Eric, these are critical spaces because these are spaces, especially where global financial policy is taking place, is being shaped. But at the same time, global climate negotiations are taking place in the UNFCCC, the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, through this process. And we also have to be engaged in that space because it's this space in particular that is also negotiating around climate finance, finance for adaptation, and also for loss and damage. And indeed, we actually managed to get a good outcome on the loss and damage fund at the last climate COP in Sharm el-Sheikh. But at the same time, these are also issues of human rights. And so we also have to be engaging in venues, including, for instance, the Human Rights Council in Geneva. And indeed, faith communities were extremely active or at the forefront of advocacy for a special rapporteur on climate change and human rights. And we were successful in that advocacy work. We do have a new, relatively new special rapporteur on climate change and human rights, looking at the intersections between climate change and human rights. And so these are many of the spaces where we, as faith communities, are engaging in, have been engaging in. And we also have the United Nations, particularly the financing for development process, which takes place in New York, where also discussions around tax issues are also taking place. I would like to say that that it's very critical that that these discussions take place, under the umbrella of the United Nations. If there is something that we have learned from these polycrises, is that the economic, the social, all the ecological are all very much deeply interconnected and deeply interlinked. And, these intersections have to be dealt with and in a coordinated and cohesive and coherent way. And I think we really need the United Nations to provide that kind of space where all of these issues can be discussed and addressed.
Thank you. I think you've highlighted again some of the dilemmas of trying to deal with everything all at once, everywhere, but also to focus so that we can find ways to make progress. Father Charles, I'm interested in your take on the role that the Catholic Church, particularly, we have on this panel a fairly Christian focus, and the Catholic Church is obviously very important. You've talked about some of the comments and positions that Pope Francis has taken, but more broadly, the Catholic Church represents an enormous network, an enormous intellectual, but also very practical. And what messages do you bring from the Catholic Church as you come to Washington next week?
Yeah, first of all, I'll be representing the Jesuit Justice and Ecology Network.
So not the whole thing.
Jenna, yeah. And we are in very good collaboration with several other Catholic actors in this space, including Episcopal conferences, including social justice groups. And just to build on what has been mentioned in terms of justice, and that's what we want to see more, the promotion of global justice, fairness in the world, and bring about structural reforms. And one thing that we are building, and we know that these reforms are coming, including the reform of the IMF, World Bank, and as Eric pointed, there's movement in the positive direction. But something that we have heard intellectuals call for is, which could even be faster in bringing about the changes that we're talking about, is the inclusion of African in an important group like the G20. At the moment, we only have South Africa in there. We're talking about a group representing over 80% of the global economy. The group of 20, G20, is the main multilateral platform for global economic and financial cooperation. And that's what we want to bring to Washington when we come, the calls by Pope Francis to promote collaboration and cooperation. He made this call very deeply and very strongly in Fratelli Tutti. And that's what we need, because the world has enough resources. The world has enough of everything for us to manage everyone to have access to the needed goods and resources of the world. So what we want to promote is financial cooperation. And we see an opportunity with this recent call of the inclusion of the AU in the G20. Firstly, the AU's growing centrality in Africa's economic governance has grown quite strong, especially you've heard about the Africa Continental Free Trade Area, AFCFTA, okay, which is bringing together 55 economies into a single market since January 2021. As a bloc, the AU now is ranked as the eighth largest in the world. So there's that sort of movement forward by Africa, and Africa is now positioned to join a group like the G20. The AU, Africa is playing a bigger role in the global economy than in previous years, and wants to even assert itself more. So there's need for room like that. And at a recent meeting that was held in an African Union, presidents called or outline topics of great importance to the continent, which included reallocation of special drawing rights and the implementation of G20's debt service suspension initiative, fair and equitable energy transition for continental access, which could be formally raised by African Union representatives in the G20 to support collective interests of African countries. This call for AU membership recognizes that the G20 is not primarily about kindness or benevolence for Africa. It's about justice. Even though so many African-related proposals are presented in this way, that's not what we are looking for. It's for cooperation. It's for a table where we could discuss structural changes that are needed in the world. And the size of the G20 and the way the platform operates provides that opportunity where Africa could now participate in the way things are run, both from the economic as well as financial perspectives. The fact is the G20 also needs African countries as they have vital resources to address energy challenges abroad. For instance, they are major suppliers of critical raw materials globally, which are required in all sorts of technology. For example, we're talking about the technology minerals that are being used to support the response to climate change, the smartphones, the electric vehicles, and several others. 64% of the EU's bauxite imports come from Guinea. 68% of cobalt, actually 80% of cobalt and tantalum come from the Democratic Republic of Congo. 71% of platinum comes from South Africa. It was the African Union as an institution that first made the case for the safe release of all grain from Russia and Ukrainian ports, including sanctions, the largest portion of which will flow to Asia and the Middle Eastern countries. The G20 has crucial agenda items such as digital payments, which African experience and innovation can inform. Yeah, Africa's climate action over the next 20 to 40 years will determine the sea level rise in locations from Amsterdam to Shanghai. So there are several global problems, global issues that Africa could contribute to, could bring to a discussion table like the G20 and make a difference. So we need to take seriously the calls of the Church of the Holy Father, especially the one I've stressed, the need to promote global cooperation, not for the sake of giving Africa a little bit of kindness, but the sake of cooperation and for the sake of global justice and for Africa to make a real contribution to the problems that we are facing.
So you have made a very powerful case for including the African Union in the G20. And this is one that the Biden administration, but also the Interfaith Forum, the G20 Interfaith Forum, has also made. And we organized a meeting in Addis Ababa in February, where that was very much a part of the agenda. The G20 is, as many of you, as all of you have stressed, a very distinctive and important forum, but has to be seen as part of the very complex and shifting global governance arrangements that we have. But clearly, one of the most vital issues is that it find ways to be inclusive at the same time that it has what the G20 often prides itself on, which is more flexibility, focus on the responsibility of leaders, and a small enough size that it is more feasible to make progress on these enormous and interconnected issues that we face. We're very close to being out of time, 1 minute. And so I think that rather than going around again, we will bring the meeting to a close. We will look at the number of questions, very good, often quite technical questions that have been raised. So we will look at those and try to respond to them. We will, I think, count on continuing this discussion. We'll look forward to hearing from all of you about your discussions next week, where you see opportunities for the partners in this meeting to contribute to the prophetic voice, but also to prophetic action. We will very much in the G20 process, both with India as the host this year, Brazil as the host next year, and then South Africa the following year, focus both at the country level, at the specific, as I think Athena has emphasized and Eric has emphasized, we need to focus on each of the capitals, each of the countries where the discussions take place, and then try to find the ways to link them and bring them together. So thank you all very much indeed. We will have the recording of this discussion available as soon as possible. And best luck to all of you in your discussions in Washington next week. Bon courage, as we say. Thank you.